So hi everyone, I'm happy to be there today for this first talk. Let me check the time, okay. So my talk today will be on games, and more precisely on memory in games, so I will tell you everything about what I mean by that. And it's a line of work I developed together with my PhD student Pierre Vandenhove, and he's co-supervised by Michael Randour in Belgium. And we have also worked with other colleagues during the trip. Okay, so I will shortly give some motivation to the work, which is related to verification and to model checking. So we want to check that a system like such a train satisfies some property like does not crash. So we don't want that to happen. We also want to satisfy possibly some quantitative constraint, for instance, on time, like on this clock. And in fact, our line of work is to model such a system with a model. So here it's a finite set of automata, and to model properties with some logical formula like this one. And we want to automatically check that the model of the system satisfies the model of the property. And a step further is not to have a full system here, but to assume that part of the system is unknown. And we want to know whether we can synthesize something here, a component of the system, which we call a controller, so that altogether the system satisfies the property we wanted to satisfy. And so this is the motivation of games, is that, in fact, if we want to know the talk in one slide, so you can rush out if you don't like it. But we want to study strategy synthesis for two-player games in the spirit of seeing games as controllers. And we want to find good and simple controllers for systems which interact with an antagonistic environment. So what do I mean by good? A good controller is something which is performant with regard to some objective, to some payoff, or to some preference relation. And simple means that it should be something that we can implement at the end, because we are, maybe I should have said that I'm from computer science, so at the end we would like the controller to be implemented. And so somehow the simple in our case will be what minimal information we need to decide the next step of the control. And the question we answer in this talk, and we were interested and we answer in this line of work, is when are simple strategies, so when are simple controllers sufficient to play optimally in a game? So we'll define everything so that you get what we mean by that. Okay, so the general approach is not something which comes from nowhere. I mean, we can find papers at the end of the last century, and we use graph-based game models to represent a system and how it evolves with time. And often a system can be viewed as a state machine, so it's an automaton which evolves when action happens. And in fact, we want to use game theory concepts to express what are the good situations of the game. And we use a concept like winning strategies that will be our focus today, but you can also think about Pareto optimal strategies if you have several objectives that you want to satisfy. You can also think about Nash equilibria or such concepts that come from game theory. Okay, games, what they are usually. If you talk to someone, probably it will be something like this. But it's a bit more than this for today, because in fact, the goal of a game is to model situation where you have interaction between agents. Agents or components of a system that interact. So for me, game is something which really can model interaction between subcomponents or between agents. And so the ingredient of a game is a set of decision makers that we call players in our case. And possibly they have different goals in the life. So I don't know, you can think of a train, you want to arrive safely at the destination, but Maybe I don't know, the driver wants something else. And there is a wide range of applicability of games. In I like the citation of this book, which is that games is a context-free mathematical toolbox. And actually, it applies to many topics in science and in social science, economics, and so on, and also in computer science. Okay, so here is the basic model that we'll use throughout this talk. So this is what we call a turn-based games on graph. So let me explain what I mean. So it's a graph, you recognize it, it's a finite graph. And you see that nodes have two types. There is one pink. There are vertices which are colored by pink and others by blue. And it means that actually the pink belongs, the state of the graph which are pink belong to player one, and the state of the graph which are blue belong to player two. Okay, so you have this set of states, it's partitioned, and there is a set of edge between the vertices, the states. Okay, oh, I was too. Okay, so I should have gone, no, this one, it's this one. Okay, so we start from the initial state S0, which is here, with a token here. And then player one chooses to go to the next vertex S1, which is here. And then this is the turn of player two, because the vertex belongs to player two, to decide, and he can decide to go down to S4. And then player two again can decide for the next edge, and can decide to go to S2, to go up again here. And then player one, because S2 belongs to player one, can decide to go down and reach this state here. Okay, so this is how we play a game, like when you play chess. Well, in chess, you cannot play it twice in a row. Here, you can play it twice in a row if it happens in the graph. But that's the same idea. So players use a tool which is what we call a strategy to play, which is something which takes a history of the game. So it's what happened in the past from the beginning of the game to now. It can so player I can decide what to do next at a state which belongs to him, so SI, and then decide for the next edge. This is exactly what we did here. Okay, so an objective will be given. So I said that we have a specification which can be given by formula. Here we will look at objectives, which are what we want to achieve in a game. And to do that, we will assume that each edge is colored by some action. So you can see its color, but for color blinded, then you can see letters. A is a letter. And in fact, an objective will simply be a set of infinite sequences of colors. So you can see here, WI is included in C omega, C being the set of colors. So for instance here, if we want to specify that at some point we reach this state, you can express it using C star B C omega with standard notational in language theory. Or you can also express what you want to achieve via payoff functions. And the payoff function can be rather general. It associates with an infinite sequence of color some real number. And for those who know, if you don't know, it's not a problem, but mean payoff can be seen like a payoff function. But you can think of many things. And you can also specify the objective of a player via some preference relation, which will be a total preorder between infinite sequence of colors. So somehow, if you have two infinite sequences of colors, then there is one that you prefer to the other, it's specified via this relation. Or maybe I should have said the sequence of colors that you consider is what you generate via your strategies. So we have seen that we went that way, and then down, so it was A, and then here we loop B. Okay, on an important hypothesis in this talk, which is restrictive. I mean, it's not, you could not do this assumption, but we assume that we make the zero-sum assumption, which means that one player has an objective, implies that the other player has the opposite objective. So for instance, if we specify the objective of a player via the subset of infinite sequence of colors, then if W1 is the objective of player 1, W2 will be the complement of W1. So this is an hypothesis on the game. And if, in terms of payoff function, the sum should be zero. This is the term zero sum. And if you consider a preference relation, then this will be the opposite relation. And so that's an assumption we make in this talk. And in this talk, we will only focus on within objectives. There are other results that we will present that apply to a more general objective like preference relation, but we prefer to focus to winning objectives. On the following, since W2 is the complement of W1, I will simply write W for W1. So the objective of player 1 will be W, and the objective of player 2 will be the complement of W. Okay, so we have seen what is a game, how we play a game via strategies. We have seen what the objective of a player. Now I will explain more formally what I mean by winning a game. So a play, I think, if you have a strategy, so which take an history and give the next move, it's rather easy to see what is something which is compatible with the strategy. You just play what your strategy tells you to play. So I don't want to go into the math. So if I take this game as before, and then I take this strategy sigma, where, so here it means that I take this edge when I'm in S0, but I don't take this one. And in S3 there is no choice, but in S2 you go down. Then the set of plays which are compatible with this strategy can be depicted via this tree that I give here. It's not really a tree, but you understand what I mean. So from S0, we go to S3. Then from S3, there is no choice anyway, you go to S4. And then you don't know what will happen. We only fix the strategy of player one. So which means that we should accept any choice from player two. And here, player two has two choices. Either go to S2 or go to this happy state. So that's why we have a branching here. And then from S2, the strategy prescribes to go down, which I go here. So somehow this strategy has two outcomes, which is S0, S3, S4, and happy guy forever, and S2, S3, S4, S2, and happy guy forever. And in this case, we'll say that if the objective is to reach the happy guy, then this strategy is winning. Sigma is a winning strategy. Okay? Now let's look at another strategy. So now it's orange. So it's this one going to S1 here. You can depict what you can generate via this strategy through this infinite tree in this case. So as before, we have branching S1 here because we have three choices in S1 and we cannot control this. And then you realize that you have branches which end up in the happy guy like previously. So that's this part of the tree. But you also realize that this guy, if he goes back to S0, it will generate some loop here, which is what happens in this infinite branch of the tree. So this strategy, the orange strategy, is not a winning strategy for player one with regard to the objective of reaching the happy guy. Okay, is it clear to everyone? Good. Okay, so a strategy of winning is if everything which is compatible is winning. And we'll say that it's optimal if it's winning. That's very nice. But it can be also the case that there is no winning strategy, in which case we'll also say that it's optimal. It's just that you have no choice on losing. Okay. And there is a nice result, which goes back to many years now, by Martins, about the determinacy of the games. So if we take turn-based games, as we have seen, possibly infinite number of states, we had finitely many states, but if you take such turn-based zero-sum games, so with a hypothesis on the two players, that one win if the other lose. Then some, and if objectives are nice enough, which is rather general because it's just supposed to be Borel, then one of the players has a winning strategy. So you fix the initial state, you know one of them has a winning strategy. Okay, so what are the relevant questions now that we know this, that there is a winning, one of the players has a winning strategy? So first, we'd like to know who is winning. And if we take the point of view of player one, we'd like to know whether player P1, player one has a winning strategy from the initial state. We'd like also to know how to win. It's nice to know that we can win, but it's better to know how to win. And how complex is it to win? And that will be our more precise objective today. Okay, if you take the NIM game, then, I don't know if you know it, but you take, in this, it's a simplified version, you take two sticks, you can take two sticks and you don't want to take the last one, otherwise you lose. Then you know you can compute the winning positions. You know that, for instance, so you know that as player one, I'm player one, so I want to win. I want to reach the state where P1 is winning. I know that if I'm in a position where there are two or one sticks, then I can win. And then I can backtrack this information up to the initial state, and I know I will be winning from 8, I don't know why it's reset here, 7, 5, 4, 2, 1. In fact, we can express the set of winning position for all the players. In fact, this applies also this backtrack computation to more general games that we play on graph like this. For instance, here, we know that this state is winning. If we target this state, we know it's winning. And we know that as I'm controlling this state, I can decide to go here if I want to win. So this state is winning. Now, this guy realizes that he has no luck, no chance to win, because if he goes there, he knows I will be winning, and here it's losing for him anyway. So this one, is all, despite it belongs to player two, it's a winning position for me. And then I can decide to go here, so I can obviously win. Just go here, see what happens, and then go and win. And so on and so forth, I know I can win from here, and then the guy realize that wherever he goes, then he will be losing because I'm winning. So all the states in these games are winning. If I add a safe loop here, obviously this state will be winning for player two because he can loop there forever and therefore never reach this goal. So we see on this example that some positions, some states are winning for me, some states are winning for the other guy. Okay, so what we do not consider here, we do not consider concurrent games. Our games are turn-based, so one player decides at each position. Oops, sorry. I have no randomized strategy, I have no randomized games, so I don't speak about what we call Blackwell games. That's out of the scope of the talk, and I don't speak about partial information. Okay, so there are I want to present you Elmer in this part. So Elmer is the colored elephant, for those who know, and he will go with us during this talk. Okay, I define strategies as general as a function that given an history of the game, so a set of states visited so far, decides the next move of the game. So it may use any information of the past. And therefore, information which is used is potentially, it's not infinite, but unbounded, because it takes any sequence of the past. And so if we target implementation, so if we want to have it on a machine which is simple, then it's not adequate to keep this point of view. So what we want is to have simplified families of strategies, and the simplest one are what we call positional, also sometimes memoryless, so it will mean the same. I will try to stick to positional, but I'm unsure about what I will say. So, in fact, positional strategies are defined in such a way that the strategy, the next move of the game, only depends on the current position, and not on the full history of the game. So in the graph we had before, in fact, when I drew a strategy with an edge from S0 to S2, or to S1, I can't remember, it was a positional strategy, because I was saying, if I'm in S0, then I take the edge down to S2. So that was a positional strategy. And positional strategy happened to be sufficient for many objectives in the literature. So reachability, as we had before, reach a target. Mean payoff, positive energy, and parity objective. So those define with colors, and you want the parity of the colors infinitely often along the play to be even or odd depending on the player. And those games require only positional strategies to win. So this was a positional strategy because it only depends on the state where we are. I'll skip that because I didn't define mean payoff, and I don't want. Okay. In fact, do we need more than positional strategy? So assume we have a game with it's only one player game, so only pink state, so a player one game. And I want to see infinitely often A and B. So A is here, B is here. So that's what we write, Bushi A and Bushi B. Then you realize that you cannot play memoryless, because here, if you play memoryless on your loop, you will see A infinitely forever. It's losing. Okay, so then I should maybe go to S2, but you realize that if you go to S2, either in S2 you loop here and you lose, or you go back, but you see C omega forever, C forever, which is not good. Actually, to win this game, we need to loop here, loop, go back. So there is some memory which is needed, which is a very small amount of memory, because you can just loop once on switch, loop once on switch. So there is very small amount of memory. Now, if you look at this other objective, which is I want to reach the happy guy here again. I want to reach it with the energy level zero. So I will explain what I mean. So I start with some extra counter, which start with zero, and then I can increase by one, so at some point, one plus one, and then minus five, and I want that this value is zero when I reach this target here. It's very easy to win. You loop five times, you go here, and it's done. But you realize that looping five times and going right, there is some memory which is required. You need to be able to count up to five, and then decide to switch. Okay, so, but you somehow we could say that in these two examples, we only need a finite amount of memory. Very small here, and then here it's just a small counter up to five. Okay, and then you have objective like, okay, multidimensional mean payoff. I will not detail you since I decided not to speak about mean payoff, but you have objective like this one, which requires infinite memory, where you realize that you need to count up to larger and larger values to be able to win. So here, you need to loop more on, you need to loop here, and then switch here, loop even more, switch here, even more, and even more. So you need infinite amount of memory. So this precise example is not important. What you should have in mind is that some objective requires infinite memory to win. Okay, so here we focus on finite memory. We want implementation, so we want finite memory. And I will define the Elmer memory, or what we call chromatic memory. And this terminology comes by, has been proposed by Kopczynski in his thesis. So, a finite memory, what does it mean to win with a finite memory? So first, we fix what we call a memory skeleton, which is a finite automaton, like this. So the states are called memory states. And what does it mean? It means that we start from the initial state. If we read an A, then we loop here in the memory. If we read an A in the arena where we are playing, we read an A here. And then if we read a B, we go here. So it's a mechanism to interpret somehow what we see in a game. So it's not yet a strategy, because a strategy should prescribe something, and this is just tracking what happens in the game and not prescribing anything. So to define a strategy, a memory skeleton needs to be accompanied by some additional next move function, which tells us, given a memory state like this one, on a state of the game, so SI is the state of player I in the game, what should be done next? And if you have you are given M on such a function, you have a strategy. It's exactly a strategy. There are strategies that cannot be represented using such a finite skeleton on a next move function, but this defines a strategy. And the positional strategy we had before can be represented using such a mechanism by taking a skeleton which is trivial, just one state and looping there forever, because then it amounts to, so this is no information, so the positional just takes the current state of the game. Okay? If there is another model of memory that is called chaotic, where you only switch here, you don't take information of the color, but of the state, but it will not be the subject today. So if I go back to this Bushy A, Bushy B, so I want to see A and B infinitely often, then we can realize that this small skeleton with two memory states is sufficient to win in any game arena. So which means that if you have you want to satisfy this, and if you have a winning strategy, it can be implemented with this skeleton and together with an alpha next, to, a next action function, which will be specific to the arena. This is specific to the objective, so next move function is specific to the arena. So a small example here, so maybe this one is more interesting. So here it's a winning strategy for this arena, for this objective. So it's simple because it just, we read, so we cannot decide what to do here. So assume that we go here with a C, for instance, so we start from M1, we go with a C here, so we loop. So we arrive in M1, S2, and here, assume that the strategy prescribes a C, which is not very optimal, but okay, it's okay. So we go here, so next move will be here. Then we are in M1, so we go back to M1, but to S3, so we go here, we say to play a B here, we go here. And then playing a B will swap to M2, and then assume we do a C again. So M2, S2, it prescribes to do an A. Oof, and we go back to the initial situation, M1, S1. We play that forever, we can realize that we have seen a B, we have seen an A, so we are winning, if we repeat this forever. You may have several such functions, but you know that if there is a winning strategy in the game, there will be one that can be implemented on this skeleton. Okay. So, zoology of notions. Maybe the one which is important, I will put everything. Oh, too fast. Okay. Maybe what is important, c'est, we'll say that W is an M-determined objective. Whenever the skeleton M, as we have seen for Bushy A and Bushy B, is sufficient to win for both players for W. So one player plays W and the other W complement. So I don't want to go in these definitions, but what we are looking at is M determinacy, where we require chromatic memory, that is, a skeleton is really based on colors and only track the color of the game. And it's arena independent in the sense that the skeleton is fixed for any arena. It should be winning for any arena and not specific to an arena. So if you go back to this example, this will be M determined for some M. We have seen it. But this will not be winning by a fixed skeleton, because you see that if I change by minus 11, for instance, and you will have to count up to 11. And So you cannot have a finite skeleton which will be working for every arena. You will have to count to any number, which is not possible if you have a finite automaton as memory. Okay? So our goal is to understand this M determinacy results. And I will first start with memoryless thing. So I can't remember what is here. Let me check. Okay. In fact, for our study, we will have to consider the finite. First, we'll assume that games are finite, and then we'll assume that games can be infinite, and we have different results in this case. Okay, so we will first look at finite games. And for that, I will go back to a paper by Jean Berzielonka in 2005. In fact, it was known at that time that we knew some conditions that guarantee positional optimal strategies for both players in games. There were some which were known. There were also some conditions which were known that would guarantee positionality of winning strategy just for P1. There was sufficient condition, not characterization. And what this paper by Jean Berzielonka gave us is a characterization of winning objective which ensure positional determinacy or memoryless determinacy in finite games. And I will tell you a bit about this result before going to finite memory. Okay, so we fix an objective, and we'll say that the objective is monotone whenever it is the case that one execution, one play is winning and the other is not winning. Then if you cut some part of the play and you replace it with some other part, which is the same, of course, it's green, and you have removed this part, you should not be able to swap the winning status of this. So it should not be the case that now this becomes winning and this becomes not winning. We need some monotonicity property of W. So this is an assumption on W that we will make. And we also have a condition which is called selectivity. Assume that we have a play which is winning, and this play is composed of something of some color. In fact, it's some regular language, but okay, it's just a picture here. And some blue part, some red, blue, red, and green. And this is winning. Selectivity means, okay, in fact, you should not have this such a complex thing. It should be the case that you see the black, but then blue forever should be winning, or red forever should be winning, or green should be winning. So that's the selectivity property. In fact, what Jean Berzielonka showed that being memoryless determined in finite arenas was equivalent to having W and W complement being monotone and selective. So some property of the objective led some property of memoryless determinacy in finite arenas. And there is also something equivalent just for one player. I want to skip that. But I want to explain the proof a little bit. So assume that all games where only player one is playing have optimal memoryless strategy. We want to show that the W is selective. So we take such a complex path and we assume it is winning. And then we take an arena of the game where there is an initial part which corresponds to this, a blue part which corresponds to this thing, which is here, some red part which is corresponds to this. I told you that those are in the definition regular languages. And the green part going here, which is the down part of the game. Then since we are memoryless determined, it means that we have a best choice at this position. And this best choice either go to blue or to red or to green. So somehow this means that one of the blue, red or green is winning. So W is selective. Okay, that's one direction of the proof. Now assume the converse, that is W is monotone selective. And now we focus on one player games. We are in a game and we have some state T where we have several options. We like to know how to play. Then, by monotony, we'll know using monotony that there is a best choice between blue and green. Okay. And by selectivity, we'll know that thereafter there is no reason to swap when we visit T one time, two times, three times. There is no reason to swap because of selectivity. So no memory will be required at this state. So there is the proof is obviously more complex, but this is a rough idea behind the proof. So this is, I think, a nice characterization of memoryless determinacy in games. It requires the hypothesis of finite arenas because we have an induction on the states of state space. Okay, and there is an application which is even nicer. It's the following. We'll see if we have time, many of them in the talk. So it's what we call a lifting theorem, which is the following. Assume that memoryless strategies suffice for W in arenas where only one player is playing. So it's simple. One player is playing means you have a graph. If you have that for the two players, so one for W and for P2 is W complement, of course. Then W is memoryless determined in finite arenas in two-player games. So that means that if you study games for only one player, and if you have nice property of W like memoryless determinacy in the two cases, P1 and P2, then you get the result in two-player arena where you have an interaction between the game. So it's really an interesting result, this lifting theorem, because it's rather easy to analyze a one-player case, because it's just a reasoning on graph. For instance, if you have a parity condition, you know that it's sufficient to have a small lasso in a one-player game, it's a graph. So proving memoryless determinacy in this one-player game is very easy. And by this theorem, you know that is memoryless determined also in a situation where you have two players that play together. And okay, we knew the result for parity games, so this is not a surprise. But in fact, this allows to prove for more complex winning objective that they are memoryless determined. Prove it on one player for just for one player and have it for the two players. Okay, so some examples. So I spoke about parity. So parity is prefix independent, which means that we don't care about the prefix. What happens is what happens immediately often. So prefix independent implies monotony. On selectivity, as I said, you have a lasso. In a graph, a winning path, which is a path which sees an even color infinitely often, the maximum color is even, which is seen infinitely often is even, you can prove that it's a simple cycle is sufficient. And so selectivity is very easy to prove for one player. Okay? So the question we asked at Pierre when he started his PhD was, can we lift this nice theorem to finite memory? And the answer is no. Oh, it's going very fast. Okay, we have an example of an objective where we can show it's finite memory in one-player games, but in two-player games, it's not finite memory. So it cannot be the case that this theorem, nice theorem, leads to finite memory in general. But hopefully we were looking at chromatic memory with this simple mechanism. Oh, with a simple mechanism I already described. And in fact, what we will show is that with that kind of memory, we'll be able to have a lifting theorem, to have this characterization on a lifting theorem. So in fact, the solution is simple, despite the fact it was long to get it. But we lift monotone to M monotone, where we only look at what happens when we reach a memory state, when we track it in the memory skeleton. So it should be the case that the green sequence and the black sequence lead to the same memory state. And for M selectivity, just that the loops should also be loops in the skeleton. And that's it. Now we have the characterization, which is that W is M determined using a fixed M, if and only if W and W complement are M monotone, M selective. So the same for one player. So we recover Jumperzy Lonka with the trivial skeleton. And we have also this Liftis theorem that I brought to you, which is even a bit more fine, is that if strategy is based on MI, some MI suffice for PI, then W will be M, the product of M1 and M2 determined in finite arenas. And the same, we get a rather powerful theorem using this lift. We study things at the one-player level, and we get result at the two-player level. So if we take as an application a reach A and a reach B, we can realize, unfortunately, I don't have time to get into the details, since I want to say a bit more on the rest. So it's not M3 monotone, but we can prove that W is M monotone for such a skeleton. But it's not M selective, okay? It's M prime selective, where M prime is this one. And in fact, we can have that W is M monotone, M prime selective. The complement of W is M monotone, M3 selective. That's something we can do by looking carefully at what it means. And then we get that memory M multiplied by M prime is a skeleton which is sufficient to win for both players in all finite arenas. That means that this skeleton, maybe you could have guessed it just looking at the specification, but that's why we have built the skeleton. This skeleton is sufficient to win for the both player if we take as a objective reach A and reach B. So reach a target A and reach a target B. Okay? Okay, as a partial conclusion, so we have a complete characterization of winning objective with finite memory determinacy with Elmer elephant memory. And we have this very nice one to two player lift, which are even more important. Okay, I want to go to infinite games. I will have to be short given the time, but. Okay, mean payoff. Maybe I should have defined it because it comes many times, but. In fact, mean payoff is an objective which is memoryless determined in the case of finite arenas. So player only need positional strategies to win. And it happens that if you look at infinite games, then you need infinite memory. So there is a discrepancy between finite games and infinite games for this kind of objectives. So somehow we could not say, okay, if I only need finite memory in finite games, then I only need finite memory in infinite games. This is wrong already for positional strategies. Okay, so we need to do something else. And we found a first insight on this on a paper by Thomas, who is sitting there, and Damian Nivinsky. They proved in 2006 that if W is prefix independent, which means that we don't care of the prefix, what is important is what's happened infinitely often, then the two following assertions are equivalent. Positional strategies are sufficient in all infinite games if and only if W is a parity condition, under the assumption that this is prefix independent. Okay, so parity condition is just you take a set of colors and you want to know which colors appear infinitely often, and this should be even for player one. Okay, that's a nice characterization. So there are some limitations, which are that there is this hypothesis on prefix independent and on positionality here. We would like to have something on finite memory. So I just recall some, so we solved, we have an answer to this question. What are the objectives that can be won with finite memory? And for that, we need some tools, which are first some tools from language theory. They are rather basic. So we take a language, so we have the array congruence, which is the Neil-Merold congruence, actually. And we know that Language is finite word is regular if and only if this congruence has finite index, and we know that we can build a deterministic automata on the classes, blah, blah, blah. You know this. And in fact, if you look at language of infinite words, because our objective are language of infinite words, it's not so nice. Somehow we know that if W is omega regular, then this congruence has finite index. Okay, we are on the safe side. And the automaton, in fact, does not recognize the language, but is what we call a prefix classifier, and we'll take it. And we also know that the converse of this, so if the congruence has finite index, it does not mean anything. Because if you take a prefix-independent language, then congruence has only one element, because prefix-independent just says that all words are equivalent with respect to W. Okay, so there is nothing very nice to take from here, but despite the notation, so the automaton that reads this based on this congruence is what we call prefix classifier, and we will use it. So our characterization is the following. We take an objective. And then what we proved is the following. W is finite memory determined with our meaning of finite memory determined, so M determined for some fixed M, if and only if W is omega regular. So, and moreover, what we know is the following, is that if M is a memory which is fine for W, so which is sufficient to win W, then W can be recognized with no by a deterministic parity automaton, but which is not built on the memory, but we need the prefix classifier on top of it. So the language will be recognized by M, the product of M with the prefix classifier. Okay, that's what we know. So somehow it generalized the result of Thomas Colcombe and Damian Nivinsky, where actually both M and MW were trivial, where the trivial Muskelton, yes. Okay, there is one direction of the proof which was given by Zelonka, and we know that parity games are determined, are memoryless determined, so this direction of the proof was known somehow. And for the other direction, it required some more work with some more difficult part as well. I want to give you examples. So we know parity objective, the prefix is prefix independent. So the prefix classifier is the trivial one, and the memory to win a parity objective is the trivial one. For this objective W, we have the prefix classifier, which is this one, and the memory to win, which is trivial. We don't need any memory to win the fact that we see to be in a word. Now we have W, which says that we see at the end AB forever, then the prefix classifier is trivial, and the memory is something like this. We can prove this. And now, in fact, we realize that, what the theorem proves is that the objective that we gave here is recognized by the product of the two, which is okay, parity objective is determined by this. And here we realize that this one is trivial, so we have to parity annotate this part of the prefix classifier. And for this objective, we have to annotate the memory, because this one is trivial. And by mixing, so if you take the disjunction of the two, then you can have one non-trivial MW and one non-trivial memory. Okay, and we have this corollary which says that we have this lifting theorem as well. We only need to prove finite memory determinacy in one player infinite arenas to get finite memory determinacy in two player infinite arenas. So we deduce that mean payoff is not mega regular. And we have some objective, like discounted objective for those who know, who are sometimes omega regular, like this one. If you take the discount factor 1/2 and the colors -2 up to 2, then you have an automaton which recognizes the objective, but otherwise no, we have a good criterion for that. And we conclude rather the same thing like for finite games. Okay. In fact, we would like to go further, but we can discuss it if you are interested offline. In fact, so far we had very nice, I think, general characterizations, but the memory bound that I gave you is not always tight in general. And in fact, that I will skip. So another interesting question is to know what are the precise memory size that are needed for the objectives, and in particular, the omega regular objective. So I had a full part on this, but I knew I would be too long. So if you are interested, we can discuss this. We have a few days for that. Okay, so what you can bring home, I hope. So in general, we can use models and concepts from game theory in a formal method like informal verification. These concepts, like winning strategies, they require to manipulate some information. And it's better to have simpler manipulation of information. So simpler strategies are better than complex strategies, of course. And in fact, our leitmotif is to use low memory. If you have low memory, it would be easier to implement, for instance. We have made some progress in understanding chromatic finite memory in these games. So we had a look at finite arenas, infinite arenas. We saw that it's not the same to win in infinite arenas and in finite arenas. We had also many 1-to-2 player lists, which are, I think, really interesting because it's much easier to analyze games with one player than games with two players. I skip this, so we don't see it, but in fact, we can also fine-tune the memory requirement for omega regular objective. We had some preliminary results, but there is maybe, you didn't see it, but I can tell you that we don't have a general understanding of this. So if you give me an omega regular objective, I cannot tell you how much memory I need to win. For some classes, yes, but not in general. So there is some room here for improvement. And also there is something that would be very nice to understand, but that I think we don't understand yet. It's not only me, but people working on this arena. Mm-hmm. And there is a lot of progress made these days. You can see all these very recent publications. So chaotic memory is when you don't see the colors, but the states, so is more precise. It's smaller. The chaotic memory is always smaller than the chromatic memory. So it's interesting, but it's even harder to understand. And in fact, there are tools, new tools that are popping up these days, like good for game automata, that are linked with this kind of memory, and universal graphs that have been developed recently also for games. And so you have seen many recent publications here. I think it's a quite active area of research these days. And there are some things to do to better understand this. Thank you.
Thank you, Patricia. So thank you for this excellent introductory talk. We have time for questions. Plenty of time because there is nothing, just a coffee break after this talk. Because we have some participants online, I will try to have you ask your questions through the microphone. So who want to ask the first question?
So you showed that there are a lot of cases where there is a 1-to-2 lifting theorem. In which cases do we not have this kind of theorems?
So there is one case, if you look at chaotic memory, we have a counterexample to the fact that if you have a finite memory, but which is chaotic, finite memory for the two players in their separate games, then you don't have the lift. So that's sad.
Any other question?
You should look behind. Me. Thank you, Patricia, for this really very interesting talk. In set theory, people consider games that last. So in set theory, people have considered games that last some countable ordinal, for example. And I know that Tom and his colleagues also work on things that require countable ordinals that are larger than omega. And I was wondering if and there are some determinist results. So I was wondering if you have studied this as well.
No, I must admit no.
Okay, so maybe it's an interesting way to extend it.
Yeah.
Any other question?
Okay, my question considers the connection with these games, with what you were saying in the very beginning, that you are controlling systems, yes? If I understand correctly, one player is to be the controller of the system, and the system itself is the other player. Is it true, or what?
It can be that. You have a system. In fact, there can be three aspects here. You have the material that you want to control. So you have to control in good way, but you can also have an environment, so some other people around. For instance, if you have an automatic car, you have the car that you need to control, but it is an environment with other cars, autonomous cars, with other cars. So that was why we look at antagonistic, because you don't know what can happen, and you have to preview the worst somehow.
I see. So my question is related to this, that there is some kind of asymmetry between the two players, yes? And I wanted to ask, does it make sense to restrict, let's say, of one player, the strength of the strategy? Because sometimes, for instance, if you control just a system that is reacting on the environment and on the action of the first player, maybe not so much reacting on the actions of the first player, but let's say in certain states it might break or not. And you assume it will break if it can break. So this would be some kind of very simple but memoryless strategy for the second player. While the first player is more rational, he has memory and he wants to prevent the system to break. So it could be, in my opinion, possible to restrict this, the strategies of one of the players to some very simple strategies. And then the question is, does it change some of these determinacy results or something?
If you fix a set of strategy for one for the second player, one for the first, not for the second.
For instance, let's say you consider the case where you allow the second player only to have memoryless strategies, but the first player can have, let's say, finite memory
arbitrary
strategies.
Yeah.
But any of them.
So I think that in that case there is a deterministic result, but somehow player one will have more chance to win. There will be more winning position for player one, and so maybe we will not need as much memory as in the general case. So that's a different setting, and I'm not sure someone has looked at the precise memory in this case, but that makes sense. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for motioning in advance.
Thank you for your nice presentation. Do you think there is a link between this monotonicity plus selectivity and pumping lemma? Because it seems you can repeat some part of the strategy or remove some part of this.
Yeah.
And it is somehow similar to the what we do in pumping lemma.
Yeah, there is something to in the philosophy there is something. In fact, maybe the pumping lemma can be used to prove selectivity for some objectives. In one player, for the proof here, there is no link in the proof with the pumping lemma. But maybe when you use this lifting theorem, Maybe you can use a pumping lemma just to simplify the kind of lassos that you have to look at. And in the philosophy, yes, there is something similar to that.
We have time for some more questions.
Thanks, Patricia, for the very nice talk. Maybe there is something in between finite and infinite memory. So you show examples of infinite memory. So sometimes it's something simple like a counter or something like that. So do you think there is something to be explored in this direction?
In fact, in the deterministic case, in the deterministic case, I don't know any objective where you need a counter-based strategy. It's a case for NDPs, stochastic games, but for deterministic, I know a strategy who require infinite memory, who require finite memory but dependent on the arena. And then below you have our kind of strategy, but I don't know any objective where you need a counter actually.
Yes, indeed. And if you think of not finite but bounded, but depending on the values in the game, like the one you showed. So
That's something that was the starting point of Pierre to look at this. But we know that there is no lift, and then we tried several conjectures that we still have, where somehow if we know one of them, I think it's this one. If you know that one of the players has a chromatic finite memory, so our kind of memory, and the other has finite memory, possibly with this energy which increases, then finite memory is sufficient, but we have no counterexample, but we have no proof either. So that's something which is, we think, rather difficult. We don't understand it.
Thanks.
Okay, one last question maybe. Okay, so let's thank Patricia again.